Howdy, everybody. Being able to identify plants and animals is a very rewarding skill to have. It's a lot of fun if you like scavenger hunts or geocaching. It gives that same kind of thrill when you find something that you've never seen before. It allows us to contribute to science in a small way by sharing our observations that might be pulled into somebody else's research. And also, when you learn what these different things are in your environment, it really makes it seem like there's much more nature around us, even if you live in a city or in the suburbs. My name is Rick Murphy, and I've been identifying plants and animals as a hobby for about 5 years. I'm not even close to knowing everything that I want to know, but it's precisely because I'm an amateur that I have to take a very methodical approach to making a good observation. So that's what I want to share with you today. One thing I've learned is that preparation is very important. There are three things we're going to need: a checklist, a digital camera, and a metaphorical library card. Then we're going to mix and match some methods, what I call top-down, bottom-up, the brute force method, and the self-explanatory ask an expert. My first attempt didn't go so smoothly. I wanted to learn how to identify trees. The only thing I did right was to make it down to the library, where I checked out a book. This one right here, The Audubon Guide to Trees. So I walked down to the local park here, book in hand, found a tree, and I started thumbing through this book from the beginning with no preparation. And I'm comparing the tree that I'm looking to everything in here, which includes all sorts of trees from all over North America. I wasn't limiting to my area here. Then when I saw something that looked similar, I really had no way of telling with confidence if it was a match. This has green leaves, that has green leaves. So I would flip to the description, read the description. It might say something like it has bipinnately compound leaves with entire margin. And I had no idea what that meant because I hadn't learned these terms. So it's really important to do a little preparation in advance, compile a checklist, and learn about the terms and so on before we go out and try to identify something. A checklist is so helpful for making an identification. All that is a list of possibilities for your favorite topic, for your area. Your area might be your state, or if you're lucky, closer to home, like your county. The more limited in range your checklist is, the easier it'll be to match something you found to something on your checklist. Everything on your checklist should have a scientific name. That means genus and species, assuming it's known to the species level. Then it should also be grouped by family, or maybe even by order or class. That way, if you narrow something down and you know what family it's in, then you can ignore everything else on your checklist. Your checklist should be as comprehensive as possible, meaning that for a topic, it comes as close as possible to listing everything in your area. Otherwise, you might simply not know if what you saw is really that thing on the checklist, or maybe just something else that looks similar. So how do you get this checklist? Well, if you're satisfied with having a checklist that covers your whole state, it may be as simple as going and getting a book. Here's Texas Trees, for example. I love this book. And here's another example, Birds of Texas. So you can use these as your checklist if you have something like that. If your area of interest is popular, like birds or butterflies, it's highly likely that you'll be able to come up with a checklist for your county. That's great if you can do that. You can go to a number of online resources like bugguide.net or inaturalist.org and do searches for your county. Often you need to merge information from numerous sources. There may be local nature centers that list things that have been sighted in their area, and if you have a few of those, you can merge those into one master list. It's good if you have a digital camera. That way you can take pictures of your subject out in the field and you can bring those back home where you've got your books and access to the internet. If you're going to be asking an expert for help online, you're going to need a digital image. And finally, after you've made your observation, if you're going to share the observation online, maybe on inaturalist.org, having a digital photo provides evidence of your sighting and increases the chance that someone else will be able to pull it into their own research. There are alternatives, of course. You can collect your specimen, but that requires permission, including permission from the government if it's on public land. You can take really good notes, but then it's particularly important to really know what to look for and know how to describe that in words. Birders are more often seen with binoculars instead of cameras. There's a couple of reasons for that. It's particularly challenging to take good photographs of distant wildlife, so it's just easier and more economical to be using binoculars instead of a camera. That means that they have to be making their observations usually there in the field. For birds, that's a little more practical because there's just simply not as many bird species as there are plants and insects. Even still, I've seen birders complain when they've seen that rare bird and they have no evidence and people don't believe them that they've taken it. There's a saying that the best camera is the camera you have with you. If you're studying plants or insects, the emphasis is going to be on close-up photography. Point-and-shoots often take surprisingly good close-up photos, so if that's what you have, give that a try. If you're serious about taking good pictures all the time, there's absolutely nothing like having an SLR, especially if you have a dedicated macro lens. But don't go run out right now and buy one unless you're interested in photography and sincerely are interested in learning how to take good pictures. So here's some photography tips. For species identification, you generally want to maximize your depth of field. That's the range from near to far that appears in focus. If you're an SLR shooter, then there's a lot of information out there about how to increase your depth of field. You also want to have accurate colors, so don't be applying Instagram filters or special effects or anything like that. Go ahead and take a lot of photos. Get straight down shots. Get straight profile shots if you can. But also, we've got to be talking about sex here, because not every species reproduces sexually, but there are a whole lot, including all of the flowering plants. The definition of a species has a lot to do with who's getting in bed with who. So you need to take good shots, good close-up shots if you can, of anything involved with sexual reproduction. For a flower, that's where you want to get your best, sharpest, closest shots. If you're interested in insects, you want to get the tip of the abdomen there. As you learn more, you may discover that some auxiliary organs that come into play, like male pedipalps on spiders, that sort of thing. Please don't be sticking your camera between the legs of any wild dogs. It's okay to skip it in that case. I like to say that you need a library card, but really that's a metaphor for all the resources that you have access to. You have friends that you know who have some expertise, the World Wide Web. But seriously, you need a library card. So if you don't have one, go get one. And visit your library's website because they may have some services like the ability to do a book search and request a book that they will find anywhere in the state and send to you and let you check out locally. There's great resources online. I'll name a couple right here. There's iNaturalist.org, I already mentioned. For plants, there's plants.usda.gov, where you can go and maybe find all the plants that they know of in your state. If you're interested in insects, there's bugguide.net, and there's many more. Do some online searches for the area of your interest. Bookmark the sites that are useful, and go to your library and see what books they have there. Check some out, maybe buy a favorite field guide for your area. Now, what you want to do is you want to do some study in advance. What you really want to do is learn the terms for the field marks for whatever it is you're interested in, insects or birds or plants or whatever, so that when you go out in the field and you're trying to identify something and you're looking up a description, you need to be able to understand what these things are. When you're first starting out, it's helpful to do this in reverse. So what you want to do is pick something that you're going to identify and then go out and find it. Or it might just be a class of things, like a family of things. So if you're interested in plants, you could, for example, learn about compound flowers and then go out and try to identify compound flowers. Are they in that family or are they not in that family? But if you're interested in birds, you could learn what's unique about sparrows and then go out and find sparrows and just look at those and make sure that you can identify that it's a sparrow or not a sparrow and so on. Do some initial study, decide what you're going to focus on at first, and then go out and just search for those things. So you put together your checklist. You walk down to your neighborhood park. You take lots of pictures of something you find down there. You come back where you're surrounded by all your library books. Now what? There are several methods we can use to make an identification, and we're going to go back and forth between these until we come up with a good identification. First method that you should become familiar with is what I'm calling the top-down method. This is the one that will give you the highest confidence that your answer is correct. in this case, you still don't always have to start at the very top. There's always some basic starting point of confidence. I assume you know instinctively whether something's a plant or an animal. So you would start where you know, and as you gain experience, you would be starting at a lower level because you just instantly know something belongs maybe to a certain family. Now here's how the top-down method works. You're going to use what's called scientific keys. These keys are basically a path to an identification. As an example, I'm looking at an introduction to the study of insects. The way it works is that each numbered item in the key comes in pairs. Starting at number one, there's two choices. This one says compound eyes present. The other choice is compound eyes absent. This is for insects. If compound eyes are present, you go to number two. If compound eyes are absent, you know what family it is. Number two, again, has two choices. One says antennae shorter than head. The other choice is antennae as long or longer than head. And so you would always have one choice that's correct and one choice that is not correct. Always read them both. If you find that neither seem to be correct, maybe you need to back up, maybe you took a wrong turn somewhere. Now there's some challenges with scientific keys. One is that they're assuming that you have this specimen in hand. It may be asking you questions like, what do the roots look like? Well, if you haven't pulled the thing out by the roots, you don't know that. At that point, you're kind of stuck. That doesn't mean necessarily that you can't come up with an identification. It just means you need to find another method. Now, it might be that you've already narrowed this down to a small set. That's where you want to start, with a set that you've already narrowed down. Anything you eliminated is eliminated for good. Another challenge is that you just can't always find these scientific keys. So there's another way to do it top down, and that is by going through descriptions of families or orders or class or so on. And if you can come across good descriptions of these, these descriptions may include field marks where you can eliminate an entire family as a choice because it doesn't fit with your specimen. That doesn't always work because sometimes families don't really have common field marks, but very often they do. And if there's something common to every species within a family, then you can potentially confirm that it's in that family or class or order, or eliminate it entirely. Another option is to use what I'm calling the bottom-up method. That's sort of cheating, but cheating is okay as long as you still come up with the correct answer. Now, in this case, you're making a guess. Maybe you have a hunch, or maybe you just looked through some pictures and you found something that looked maybe like it's a match. So here's an example of how we might do that. This is a book called Wildflowers of Texas. Notice this book is color-coded on the edges here. That is not a very scientific approach because it's not like there's a family of yellow flowers and a family of blue flowers. In fact, some flowers, like the cornflower, could potentially be blue or magenta or white. Furthermore, this book is not comprehensive. It says so in the introduction if you read it. It's not all the flowers out there. So if you browse through here and look what might be a match, you really can't say with any confidence that that is a match because there could be other flowers that look very similar and just aren't in this book. Or maybe sometimes they come in another color and they're somewhere else in this book. That doesn't mean that this book isn't useful. We just need to apply the bottom-up method. So you somehow, like browsing through photos, for example, come up with a possible candidate for a match. Read the description, if there's a description that goes with it, and that may eliminate or confirm that you found something. But what you want to do is now take the bottom-up approach. You go up a level. So starting with a species, go up a level and see if other things in that same genus that exist on your checklist are equally likely matches. If they are, again, take it up a level. Maybe there are other genera in the same family that are equally likely matches. If they aren't, if the siblings don't look anything like this, this gives you a higher confidence that you've actually narrowed it down correctly to species or genus or family. You want to keep going up until you get to a level where you are confident that you have placed your specimen in the correct family or genus. Keep in mind that things sometimes look more like something they're unrelated to than things they're closely related to. This is more the exception than the rule, but it does happen. For example, the pipevine swallowtail butterfly looks similar to a couple other butterflies that it's not closely related to. But this is a known trait that is similar to these other things it's not closely related to. And this will often be mentioned in descriptions, so keep an eye out for this information. So once you're at a level where you have some confidence, again, you want to switch to top-down method from there and try to use scientific keys or maybe even the brute force method to identify it back down to species. The brute force method is what I was essentially trying to use when I made my first failed attempt to identify trees in my local park. But really, you want to do a better job than that. Usually, you want to narrow things down as much as you possibly can. When you get to a point where maybe you have a dozen or less things that are possibilities, then it becomes much more practical to go through one by one, read the descriptions for each of these things, and identify it in that brute force manner. Now, when you do this, it's especially important to have a good checklist, because you might find something that looks similar, and you have to know that there's not something else that's equally possible. So when you finally decide that you're going to brute force your way through a subset of possibilities, you want to go through this whole set. You don't want to stop as soon as you find something that looks like a match, because it's quite possible that there's other things that are equally likely, and you have to be a little more diligent and look a little closer to distinguish these. I already mentioned a couple online resources like Bug Guide and iNaturalist, where you can post an image and an expert might help identify that for you. Another one is Flickr identification groups. You can go to Flickr, search in the groups for bird identification or whatever your subject of interest is, and there's some groups where you can post a photo and somebody may identify it for you. Here's a couple tips for when requesting help from an expert. Crop your photos down to just your subject. And you always want to include some basic information. You always want to know where it was taken. You don't necessarily need GPS coordinates, but you need to know at a minimum what county you were in, and also the date and maybe time when you took the photograph, because many things are seasonal. Okay, that's it. That's the video. That was a very brief introduction into an approach of how to identify things. I hope it's helpful. If you are located in Texas, check out my website, texasnature.net. There's more information, lists of all the plants and animals that I know of that exist in Texas, plus links to many resources that I use online. If this was helpful, leave a comment below. Let me know. Have a good day.